Simon & Schuster Audio presents
Empire of the Summer Moon, Quanah Parker and the Rise and Fall of the Comanches, the Most Powerful Indian Tribe in American History, by S.C. Gwynne. Narrated by David Drummond. 1. A New Kind of War. Cavalrymen remember such moments. Dust swirling behind the pack mules, regimental bugles shattering the air, horses snorting, and riders' tack creaking through the ranks, their old company song rising on the wind. Come home, John, don't stay long. Come home soon to your own Chickabiddy. The date was October 3, 1871. 600 soldiers and 20 Tonkawa scouts had bivouacked on a lovely bend of the Clear Fork of the Brazos in a rolling, scarred prairie of grama grass, scrub oak, sage, and chaparral about 150 miles west of Fort Worth, Texas. Now they were breaking camp, moving out in a long, snaking line through the high cutbacks and quicksand streams. Though they did not know it at the time, the idea would have seemed preposterous, the sounding of boots and saddle that morning marked the beginning of the end of the Indian Wars in America, of fully 250 years of bloody combat that had begun almost with the first landing of the first ship on the first fatal shore in Virginia. The final destruction of the last of the hostile tribes would not take place for a few more years. Time would be yet required to round them all up, or starve them out, or exterminate their sources of food, or run them to ground in shallow canyons, or kill them outright. For the moment, the question was one of hard, unalloyed will. There had been brief spasms of official vengeance and retribution before, J.M. Chivington's and George Armstrong Custer's savage massacres of Cheyennes in 1864 and 1868 were examples. But in those days, there was no real attempt to destroy the tribes on a larger scale, no stomach for it. That had changed, and that morning the change assumed the form of an order, barked out through the lines of command to the men of the 4th Cavalry and 11th Infantry to go forth and kill Comanches. It was the end of anything like tolerance, the beginning of the final solution. The white men were grunts, bluecoats, cavalry, and dragoons. Mostly veterans of the war between the states, who now found themselves at the edge of the known universe, ascending to the turreted rock towers that gated the fabled Llano Estacado, Coronado's term for it, meaning palisaded plains of West Texas, a country populated exclusively by the most hostile Indians on the continent, where few U.S. soldiers had ever gone before. The Llano was a place of extreme desolation, a vast, trackless, and featureless ocean of grass, where white men became lost and disoriented and died of thirst. A place where the Imperial Spanish had once marched confidently forth to hunt Comanches, only to find that they themselves were the hunted, the ones to be slaughtered. In 1864, Kit Carson had led a large force of federal troops from Santa Fe and attacked a Comanche band at a trading post called Adobe Walls, north of modern-day Amarillo. He had survived it, but had come within a whisker of watching his three companies of cavalry and infantry destroyed. The troops were now going back because enough was enough, because President Grant's vaunted peace policy toward the remaining Indians, run by his gentle Quaker appointees, had failed utterly to bring peace, and finally because the exasperated General-in-Chief of the Army, William Tecumseh Sherman, had ordered it so. Sherman's chosen agent of destruction was a Civil War hero named Ranald Slidell McKenzie, a difficult, moody, and implacable young man who had graduated first in his class from West Point in 1862 and had finished the Civil War, remarkably, as a brevet brigadier general. Because his hand was gruesomely disfigured from war wounds, the Indians called him No Finger Chief or Bad Hand. A complex destiny awaited him. Within 4 years, he would prove himself the most brutally effective Indian fighter in American history. In roughly that same time period, while General George Armstrong Custer achieved world fame in failure and catastrophe, Mackenzie would become obscure in victory. But it was Mackenzie, not Custer, who would teach the rest of the army how to fight Indians. As he moved his men across the broken stream-crossed country, past immense herds of buffalo and prairie dog towns that stretched to the horizon, Colonel Mackenzie did not have a clear idea of what he was doing, where precisely he was going, or how to fight Plains Indians in their homelands. Neither did he have the faintest idea that he would be the one largely responsible for defeating the last of the hostile Indians. He was new to this sort of Indian fighting, and would make many mistakes in the coming weeks. He would learn from them. For now, Mackenzie was the instrument of retribution. He had been dispatched to kill Comanches in their Great Plains fastness because, 6 years after the end of the Civil War, the western frontier was an open and bleeding wound, a smoking ruin littered with corpses and charred chimneys, a place where anarchy and torture killings had replaced the rule of law, where Indians, and especially Comanches, raided at will. Victorious in war, unchallenged by foreign foes in North America for the first time in its history, the Union now found itself unable to deal with the handful of remaining Indian tribes that had not been destroyed, assimilated, or forced to retreat meekly onto reservations where they quickly learned the meaning of abject subjugation and starvation. The hostiles were all residents of the Great Plains. All were mounted, well-armed, and driven now by a mixture of vengeance and political desperation. They were Comanches, Kiowas, Arapahoes, Cheyennes, and Western Sioux. For Mackenzie on the southern plains, Comanches were the obvious target. No tribe in the history of the Spanish, French, Mexican, Texan, and American occupations of this land had ever caused so much havoc and death. None was even a close second. Just how bad things were in 1871 along this razor edge of civilization could be seen in the numbers of settlers who had abandoned their lands. The frontier, carried westward with so much sweat and blood and toil, was now rolling backwards, retreating. Colonel Randolph Marcy, who accompanied Sherman on a western tour in the spring and who had known the country intimately for decades, had been shocked to find that in many places there were fewer people than 18 years before. "If the Indian marauders are not punished," he wrote, "the whole country seems in a fair way of becoming totally depopulated." This phenomenon was not entirely unknown in the history of the New World. The Comanches had also stopped cold the northward advance of the Spanish Empire in the 18th century, an empire that had, up to that point, easily subdued and killed millions of Indians in Mexico and moved at will through the continent. Now, after more than a century of relentless westward movement, they were rolling back civilization's advance again, only on a much larger scale. Whole areas of the borderlands were simply emptying out, melting back eastward toward the safety of the forests. One county, Wise, had seen its population drop from 3,160 in the year 1860 to 1,450 in 1870. In some places, the line of settlements had been driven back 100 miles. If General Sherman wondered about the cause, as he once did, his tour with Marcy relieved him of his doubts. That spring, they had narrowly missed being killed themselves by a party of raiding Indians. The Indians, mostly Kiowas, passed them over because of a shaman's superstitions and had instead attacked a nearby wagon train. What happened was typical of the savage, revenge-driven attacks by Comanches and Kiowas in Texas in the post-war years. What was not typical was Sherman's proximity and his own very personal and mortal sense that he might have been a victim too. Because of that, the raid became famous, known to history as the Salt Creek Massacre. 7 men were killed in the raid, though that does not begin to describe the horror of what Mackenzie found at the scene. According to Captain Robert G. Carter, Mackenzie's subordinate, who witnessed its aftermath, the victims were stripped, scalped, and mutilated. Some had been beheaded, and others had their brains scooped out. Their fingers, toes, and private parts had been cut off and stuck in their mouths, wrote Carter, and their bodies, now lying in several inches of water and swollen or bloated beyond all chance of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.